in this country is this. They have demonized poverty so much that elected officials won't let the word come out of their mouths. You hear all the elected officials talking about fighting for the middle class, middle class, middle class, middle class. You don't hear the word poor. You don't hear the word poverty. You don't hear the words welfare. And they've been allowed to do it because we don't have the fight and the struggle. And so that's really what we need, Margaret. We need to organize and be radical about it. And lastly, let me just say this. I'm told, and I don't know how true it is, that 50% of the kids at Crenshaw High are in foster care. That is outrageous. And you're absolutely right. The simple truth that was spoken here, if you can pay somebody to take care of somebody else's kids, why can't you pay the person?
Well, the mission has always been basically the same, as the protection of children and providing a vehicle for permanency so that each child would have a permanent home.
So on the one hand, Children's Services can be a very good advocate for children and children who often don't feel like they have voice to say, there's something going on with me that's not right. And sometimes kids can't articulate that. And having an agency that sort of protects that kind of the welfare of children is a good thing. I've also seen the flip side.
Protection, again, comes back to a philosophical, what were we protecting them from? Originally it was child abuse. Now we have the expansion of the definition of child abuse into a broader range of problems and issues.
Most parents who lose their children to foster care are neither brutally abusive nor hopelessly addicted. Far more common are cases in which a family's poverty has been confused with child neglect.
People of color, people who don't have the finances, they may not be able to afford the attorney or afford going to counseling and that kind of thing. They're sort of left to their own volition, and it becomes a spiraling, out of control situation that leaves people feeling disengaged, disenfranchised, and not validated.
The largest ethnic group in foster care were African Americans. And although they were only about 10 or 12% of the county, we had 40% of the foster care population is African American. So that was a disjoint right there.
Brings on a lot of survival kinds of things that people have to do, and it may not be acceptable in a world like America, where things are supposed to be, you know, land of milk and honey, but milk and honey doesn't run in the land of a lot of our urban and underprivileged situations. It's just not that sweet.
Thank you for being here for our event, Does Caregiving Count? Budget Cuts, Child Welfare, and Poverty. There's a lot going on in Southern California today, so we are delighted to see so many of you here, particularly those of you who are impacted not only by the policies of DCFS, but also by the cuts in welfare and other cuts that were...
Just to say how the group began here, was through a community dialogue, which the Global Women's Strike and Every Mother is a Working Mother had organized.
And a number of women came to that meeting who, as it turned out, had cases with DCFS. Either they had previous cases or they were actually involved in the system right then and there.
There's a fairly wide assumption that the parents have been abusive or grossly neglectful, and so there was some really good reason for DCFS to come in and snatch these children away. But what we found is the reasons are bizarre sometimes, are arbitrary sometimes, have to do with the preconceptions of the social worker sometimes.
So it was natural then for us to want to do a follow-up, and we did. And a number of women came to that meeting, and they were raring to go. In fact, when we first started, we were meeting, I want to say, a couple of times a week. I mean, it was very, very intense.
DCFS never taken, you know, had any involvement with Brittany, from where it was concerned, and Harmony, none whatsoever. Until Brittany and her brother, who I raised, both were killed at her house while Harmony was at school. This was a trauma on us, along with Harmony. And so what they did, they just ripped Harmony away from us. And no matter how she cried for us or we cried for her, they didn't care. DCFS placed her with strangers. And I tried to explain, and I got all kind of paperwork. I had over 40 letters, you know, at least 40 letters from all different types of organization and doctors, school, stating that, you know, they witnessed her being with me from the church.
Department of something social servants took my sister away, and I don't feel good. Now my family's missing something. And every day I start to a little cry.
I feel sad, like something missing from my heart. Like my heart is half broken and taken away.
Even there in the court, Harmony just started just telling the judge, please, please, I want to go to Auntie May, I want to go to Auntie May.
Grandbaby, I still took care of her with what was left of my money. Mm. But it was like this. She would sleep in a crib in the bedroom, and I slept on the floor. Mm. And because I couldn't afford a bed, I couldn't afford nothing, I slept on a hard floor. And that's how it started. It's just all of a sudden, everything just started happening so fast. Workers was coming out of the walls, all type of workers. Buy this, or you need to buy that, or you need to buy this. Mm-hmm. They've been sending me through this all constantly. Mm-hmm. And then still, I have to take the money that I would pay my bills with, or buy food with, and buy diapers and things for the baby. Mm-hmm. So I say, I need a medical card. If the baby gets sick, I need to go to the doctor. I need to be able to take the baby to the doctor. So I told the workers this for months and months, and they wouldn't help me, you know. And so I'm saying, they don't care about this baby.
No.
How can they do this?
Why we came to the attention of DCFS is because a dentist called the department stating that we were neglecting our child's medical needs.
The dentist?
Yes.
And, the dentist?
Yes, because we went to a dentist and there was some dental issues that our daughter needed to go through. And pretty much she wanted to put silver fillings, which are some of those silver fillings contain mercury.
Yeah.
And toxin, and we were really in disagreement with the dentist about that. So we let the dentist know that we were in disagreement with that and that we wanted to pretty much get a second opinion.
Yeah.
And as soon as my wife let them know that we wanted to get a second opinion, within a few days we had to be a social worker. Emergency responder at our house.
We barely went to one of the doctors. They wanted to put like a metal tooth on my mouth. And, my mom and dad didn't let me, and they didn't let them put it on my mouth. And then they were protecting me from that.
Mm-hmm. DCFS caused our family just has been emotional, psychological, and now physical pain. Something that the department in itself has stated that they will not do. You know, according to their mission statement, is they're there to you know, protect and care for children and even the family. But obviously, they were not even considered of our family, or they were not even culturally sensitive to us because we do things so different as our ancestors, you know, did and continue to do. We were trying to do everything, you know, naturally, because we like to do the holistic approach, the most safe approach, and, you know. So, you know, here we are now trying to, you know, fight the county or the department and, you know, that what they're doing is wrong, and, but, you know.
I can't believe that we're still living.
The violence and the things that he was doing in the presence of me and the kids, and I was, where do I go? Where, you know, the police aren't helping me. Police are not helping me. So I went to DCFS to get the help, and I also went to my children's school. Well, that's when the nightmare started. When they came into the picture, things started turning around where I was the bad person. I was the unfit mother. I was the one that had to go take drug tests. I was the alcoholic. I was everything that he was. It was just so twisted and backwards. When I would try to defend myself in court, the judge would literally tell me to shut up. The feeling in the room and the courtroom was like, she's nothing, she's no one, no one pay attention to her, let's just continue on with what we're doing here. And that's pretty much how it's been. So it's you know, like I was explaining to her, you know, it makes me cry because The abuse is continuing. It's not ending.
Yeah.
The abuse is continuing, and it's spread. It started with me, and it spread out to my children, and now it's just continuing to just take place. And that's the hardest part for me, is that the abuse has spread out to where it's harming my children. I'm the adult, so I feel that because I'm the adult, I have that strength. But their children, have mercy on the kid. That's my biggest heartbreak.
We're a self-help group. It's not an advocacy organization. It's not an NGO, a non-governmental organization. We're all volunteers. We're all in it together. So we had to hammer out our terms of reference.
So we took on the coordinating work of putting it. Getting a group together here.
A lot of emotion, a lot of passion, a lot of pain. People wanted help with individual cases. They wanted to protest down at Children's Court. And it was really an outpouring of what had happened to them that had been pent up for so long, because there really wasn't an advocacy group dealing with this particular issue.
And most of the people that I've spoken with, they love their children, and they are devastated by their children being taken away.
After getting involved with DCFS to give us back our children, it just seemed like, you know, it was a sort of a light, because, you know, I've met people that was going through the same thing. And it's one thing after another that really, it's been a very, very great experience to meet someone that really want to change things.
In addition to working to win cases, we're also working to affect the practice and policies of DCFS itself to impact and make changes, because it is a systemic problem.
So we think that the more open and visible these kinds of situations are, the more the public will demand that DCFS behave much more in the interests of children, and that the resources are spent more on keeping families together and in finding the kind of help that families need so that the children can stay safely there and not spend so much paying for foster care and for legal services to keep kids out of their families. We think that the priorities are not right.
It seems like when we are there demonstrating and we have the media with us, they somewhat want to get righteous for a second. And one of the ladies, some people came out, they was excited. This little boy, he ran over to us and she said, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. And we didn't know what he was thanking for. And the mother said, they gave us our daughter back because of you guys. And we had a lot of people come. Because of you guys being here, they are being really nice today. So, you know, that give you a light. That was wonderful to hear. It really make you feel good that, wow, you're doing something to help somebody. That's the joy you get from it.